Okay, I'm going to be looking at Isaiah chapter 1. Isaiah chapter 1. And I want to start out just giving you some facts about the book of Isaiah because it's one of the most interesting books in the Bible. And what you got with Isaiah is Isaiah means Jehovah is salvation or save thou Jehovah. This book begins the major prophets. Now, it's not more important than the minor prophets, but it's just bigger. The major prophets aren't more important, they're just bigger. You got 66 chapters, 1,292 verses, and 37,044 words. The author is Isaiah. The historical time is from around 760 BC to 698 BC. And Isaiah prophesied during the reign of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah. And the theme is the day of the Lord. That's going to be the theme. Historically, okay, our three applications, historical application, is Isaiah is sent to Israel and Judah to warn of coming judgment if they don't get right with God. Devotionally, you should be in Isaiah and say, Lord, here am I, send me. Devotionally, you could say, if I don't get right with God, then God's going to bring judgment on me. Doctrinally, what you have is Israel during the tribulation, the second coming, and throughout the book, note the phrase in that day because it's going to have to do with the second coming and the millennial reign. Okay, this is really important here and amazing. Isaiah has 66 chapters, and that will match the 66 books of the Bible. In Isaiah 1 and verse 2, it says, Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord hath spoken. He said, I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me. That will match Genesis. What did he say in Genesis? In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And he said, Here, he says, Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth. Then you get to Isaiah chapter 40. You're going to have a prophecy of John the Baptist. And then you get to the 40th book of the Bible. What happens? Up shows up John the Baptist. You get to Isaiah 66:22. It talks about a new heaven and a new earth. You get to the 66th book of the Bible. It talks about a new heaven and new earth. And the amazing thing is, that was Isaiah 66:22. It talks about a new heaven and new earth. Revelation 22. And you see that all the way through Isaiah. They call Isaiah like a mini Bible, a Bible inside the Bible. Here's some more Isaiah facts. Isaiah has 23 commands to hear. So you need to hear. Isaiah is the most frequently quoted book by Jesus Christ and New Testament writers. Isaiah is the largest book with chapters in the Bible because Psalms is made up of Psalms. Isaiah is made up of chapters, so it's the largest book made up of chapters. Isaiah is contemporary with Hosea, Micah, and Nahum. Isaiah married a prophetess and they have two sons in chapter 7 and verse 3, chapter 8 and verse 3, and verse 18. One of his sons' name is Maher Shalal Hashbaz. That's the longest name in the Bible. Here's a quick breakdown for Isaiah. Chapters 1 through 5 is during the life of Uzziah. Chapter 6, during the reign of Jotham. 7 through 12, under Ahaz. 13 through 66, under Hezekiah. That's breaking down the book in terms of him prophesying at each king's reign. And Isaiah has so much to say about the Lord Jesus Christ. So a lot of people call it the fifth gospel, or the gospel according to Isaiah. In chapter 7 and verse 14, you got the birth of Jesus Christ. In chapter 9 and verse 6, you got the incarnation. In 7:15, you got his lowly status. In 42 and verse 14, you got Jesus as a servant. In 61, 1 through 3, you got his anointing. In 40, verses 3 through 6, you got his forerunner. In 1 and verse 5, you got obedience. In 61, verses 1 through 2, you got his message. In chapter 35, you got miracles. In 6, 9 through 11, you got Israel's rejection of him. In 11, 2, you got his subjection to the Father. In 42, 2 through 3, you got his method. In 8, 14, he's the stone of stumbling. In chapter 42, 6 through 7, you got his ministry to the Gentiles. So that's a quick overview there of Isaiah. Now let's jump into the book itself. So Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 1. Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 1. And we're going to be looking at the sinful nation of Israel. That's who the book is directed to, sinful nation of Israel and America. It's not directed to America, but we're going to be, you know, since we live in America, we could be thinking about America as he's talking about a sinful nation. And also look at yourself and you being a sinful creature that you are. Look at Isaiah 1:1. The vision of Isaiah, the son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. So the vision. Before there was a complete Bible, the Lord talked to people through dreams, through visions, and things like that, because they didn't have a complete Bible. They didn't have everything, all the words that they needed. Today, me and you, it's different. We got all the words that we needed in the 66 books of the Bible. That's confirmed by the book of Isaiah itself, which has 66 chapters that lines up with those 66 books. But before, like Numbers 12:6, it says, "And he said, Hear now my words, if there be a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known unto him in a vision, and will speak unto him in a dream." So that's how he made his words known at that time. "Now the Lord makes himself known to me in the scriptures only. He speaks to me through the word of God in the King James Bible. Now we have a perfect, inspired, and preserved word. He talks to us through the 66 books, and it is a more sure word of prophecy according to 2 Peter 1:19. The Apostle Peter walked and talked with Jesus. He saw Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration with Moses and Elijah. He saw him pick up a man's ear, put it right back on his head after he had cut it off. Peter saw a lot of amazing things with his own two eyes. He didn't just operate by faith, he operated by sight. He saw signs because the Jews require a sign. But he still, with this, when it comes to the scriptures, he said, we have a more sure word of prophecy. The Bible is more sure than if you saw an angel come to you at night with your own two eyes. The scriptures are more sure. So Isaiah's dad is Amos, but it's not Amos the minor prophet. It's another Amos. Isaiah was a prophet to the southern kingdom of Judah. And I've also read that he prophesied to the northern kingdom up until their destruction, but they've been destroyed at this time. And now he's just a prophet to the southern kingdom of Judah, during the reigns of these specific kings, during the reigns of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. And all these guys were pretty good kings, except for Ahaz. He was an evil king. So even though Isaiah, if you look at your Bible and open it, the book of Isaiah shows up after, you know, 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles. But that's when the book is actually going on, is during those books of the kings, specifically 2 Chronicles 26 through 31. That's when Isaiah's prophesying. And if you realize that, it's going to really open up your Bible, because you're going to realize that these major prophets and these minor prophets, they're actually prophesying during those books of the kings, like in Kings and Chronicles. That's when they're alive and prophesying. So even though they're at the end of the Old Testament, they actually, when it comes to when they prophesied, it's actually during those books of the kings. And so he's prophesying to Uzziah during the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah. Compare that to how presidents of the past got advice or preaching from men like Billy Graham, or Trump gets advice from Paula White. Stuff like that. And you see, that's a shame, because imagine if they got to hear the preaching of Isaiah. They might have really got right with God. And, you know, Billy Graham, he really compromised. And then Trump with Paula White, that's just a shame. But yeah, you look up Billy Graham and presidents, and he's got the opportunity to speak to a lot of different presidents. But do these people really care what the Bible says, what the preacher says? What they need is real preaching from real Bible preachers. Imagine if somebody like Danny Castle or Donnie Dalton got to just go preach to a whole bunch of wicked politicians and just open up the Bible and scream and holler. And I just thought it, I sit and think about it, and I thought it'd be so funny if they heard some preaching like this.
I'd rather have Jesus than riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than all this. I'll tell you, to God, amen. Who's going there? Rich people's going there. In Luke chapter 16, verse 22, amen. When the beggar died, the angels carried him into Abraham's bosom. And the rich man also died and was buried. And in hell, he lifted up his eyes, being in torment, cried out to Father Abraham, have mercy. Yep. Oh God, have mercy. Honey, I'm telling you, pleasure-seeking people go to hell. Yep. Look who goes to hell, the pomp, the multitudes. What Jesus say about it?
Yeah, I just randomly clicked on that. I didn't even know that it was going to come up to him saying that specifically. But imagine a preacher like Donnie Dalton getting up and preaching to the president today and telling him rich men go to hell. Evil men that reject the Lord Jesus Christ go to hell. Imagine that. Imagine if somebody like Danny Castle got up there and showed one of those video presentations that he does exposing the evil of the world to the people that are spreading the most evil in the world. That's what it was like with Isaiah prophesying to Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah. And maybe Isaiah was just a great prophet, a great preacher, because most of these kings were good kings. Uzziah, Jotham, and Hezekiah was good kings. And it's a shame that the best preaching that they got's Billy Graham. And then you take a really, really big step down to Paula White. Why that Trump would think that he needs spiritual advice from a woman half his age, is, that's just a sad thing. But imagine, you know, they get some real Bible preaching from Danny Castle, Donnie Dalton, David Hoffman, David Peacock, somebody like that. Somebody to tell them the truth. Get them something from the Bible. But that's what it's like. Isaiah, he had a long ministry. I mean, his ministry stretched out with all these kings of over 50 years. So you can see he fought a good fight. He finished his course. He kept the faith. Just like a lot of preachers today, just like the ones we just mentioned. You know, Danny, he's been at it for like 50 years. Donnie's been at it for like 42 years. David Hoffman, probably like almost 40 years. And Isaiah's going to tell you what he saw. Just as John tells you about what he saw with his own two eyes in the book of Revelation, it seems that John was picked up and carried forward in time and saw the events of the tribulation. And Isaiah seems to be picked up and carried somewhere and gets to see with his own two eyes what he's going to write. And he's going to tell us about the wickedness of Judah. Judah would be the tribe, the people, Jerusalem, the city. So the vision of Isaiah, the son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. He says in Isaiah 1 and verse 2, "Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord hath spoken. I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me." Now, remember I told you, Isaiah chapter 1 is going to match the first book of the Bible, Genesis. You can line up the chapters of Isaiah with the books of the Bible. And since we're in Isaiah chapter 1, it's going to match up with the first book of the Bible. He says, "Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth." What did the Lord say in Genesis? In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. He says, "The Lord hath spoken." That'll match. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth was out form and void, and darkness upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, so the Lord hath spoken, Genesis 1:3. See, the Bible is just amazing. He says, so hear, because the Lord hath spoken. God speaks. God speaks to his creation. He cares about his creation. He's not just forsaken us and gone away and ran away from the creation. God actually talks to his creation, contrary to what people think. God is actually open for you to talk to him 24 hours a day for your entire life. He never closes. And you got all these celebrities and famous people and athletes you look up to that don't even know who you are. They don't even know you exist. But the God Almighty that made Adam and Eve, that parted the Red Sea, that talked in the burning bush, that helped David fight Goliath, he is available to talk to you at this exact moment and is desiring to talk to you. That's an amazing thing. But you see, the Lord brought up children, it said. He said, "I have nourished and brought up children." That'll match Genesis. What did he do in Genesis? He brought up children, Adam and Eve. He brought up Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. That was Israel, his children. He said, "I've nourished and brought up children, but his children have rebelled against him." Does this mean God's a bad father? Absolutely not. It proves that man has a free will. He's nourished and brought up children, but they've rebelled. He didn't make them love him. He didn't make little robots pre-programmed to do everything he said. You see, God doesn't force you to choose the right way. You see, just because a parent has a rebellious son doesn't necessarily mean that they're a bad father or a bad mother. A child has to choose of his own free will to submit to the parent. And no matter your tactic of parenting, if they don't submit to you, you can't get them to do anything. You can spank a kid all day. If he doesn't choose to submit, it's not going to work. You can take away things from him all day. If he doesn't choose to submit, it's not going to work. You can talk to him all day and try to lead him the right way. If he doesn't choose to submit, it's not going to work. The angels had to choose the Lord. Man has to choose the Lord. If they don't choose the Lord, It doesn't mean he's a bad father. It proves that that man is wicked and unrepentant. But Genesis shows you, the book of Genesis, the first book of the Bible, shows you man's rebellion against God in Genesis chapter 3, when man ate off the tree. They were given one command, don't eat off of that tree. What do? They ate off the tree. And that's just the sinful nature of man. And now in Isaiah 1 and verse 3, he says, the ox knoweth his owner, and the ass his master's crib. But Israel doth not know, my people doth not consider. So the ox knows his owner. The ass his master's crib, where he knows where his manger's at. They know where to get the food at. They know the hand that feeds them. And Proverbs 14 and verse 4, it says, where no oxen are, the crib is clean. But much increase is by the strength of the ox. You see, an ox is a worker. And 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed. A workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. An ox is a worker. And if our master's crib is the word of God, you see, our master's crib, where we go to see the master or to get food from him, if it's the word of God, then for most Christians, their crib is just spotless. It's clean. Where no oxen are, the crib is clean. If you don't spend much time in the master's crib, that thing's going to be clean. Your Bible is going to look like you just bought it yesterday, even though you've had it for 10 years, because you don't know where to go to get fed. But if you are a workman, that thing's filled up. It's showing signs of age, it's showing signs of wear, and it's got marks all over it. Like this interleaved Bible right here. You can tell there's been an ox working in it. Laboring in it. You want to study to show yourself approved unto God. Be a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Much study is a weariness to the flesh, and you want to labor in the word and doctrine. So the ox knows his owner. As does the ass. They know who gives them a place to live and food to eat. Yet most people have no idea who's allowing them to have everything that they have. When you don't acknowledge God as being the one who gives you everything you have, then you are like a dog who thinks he's putting a roof over his own head and providing dog bones for himself. He says, ah, sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity. This sinful nation is Israel. They're dumber than an ox. He said, the ox knows his owner. You're dumber than an ox. The ass knows his master's crib. You're dumber than a jackass. Job said, and I believe Job 11:12, he says, man is born like unto a wild ass's colt. You're dumber than him. You know, born like unto a wild ass's colt. That's where you get the saying, born to be wild. He said, the ox knoweth his owner. He said, but my people doth not know. They do not consider. That's where you get the saying, dumber than an ox. You see, the animal's got more sense than you got. God compares men to beasts throughout the Bible. He calls them brute beasts in the book of Jude. And he says, ah, sinful nation. You can insert America there too, even though it's talking about Israel. This is a sinful nation you're living in. A people laden with iniquity. A seed of evildoers, children that are corruptors. They have forsaken the Lord. They have provoked the Holy One of Israel into anger. They are gone away backward. Israel is the sinful nation. So doctrinally it's to Israel. Practically, you could apply it to your country that you're living in or any other sinful nation. We could even apply it to ourselves because if we are sinful, then we get laden with iniquity. That means we get loaded down with iniquity. And Hebrews 12:1 says, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that's set before us. If we don't lay aside this sin and all this weight, we can't run the race. You see, you're getting all this sin on your back, and it's loading you down so that you can't run the race. And so the more you sin, the more harder the path's going to be. Proverbs 13:15 says, the way of transgressors is hard. You got a rough road ahead. Because the way of transgressors is hard. It's going to be like just a little toddler or a little kid trying to carry a grown man's heavy backpack. He's just going to fall right over. Iniquity will be your ruin. Ezekiel 18:30. But Jesus said, Matthew 11:28, here's that word, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So, a people laden with iniquity, are you laden with iniquity? Jesus said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. Come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Get the sin off your back. Get the wrath of God off your back if you're not saved. Get the sin off your back if you're saved and just not living right. It says in Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 4, he calls them a seed of evildoers. That will match the serpent seed of Genesis 3:15. Remember, we're lining this up with the book of Genesis, since it's the first book of the Bible. He says a seed of evildoers. He talks about the serpent seed in Genesis 3:15. He calls them a seed of evildoers. Their seed will just be more evil, because 2 Timothy 3:13 says, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. The worse you are, the worse your kids might be. The worse they are, the worse your grandkids might be. That is, unless they get a hold of God. Things get worse and worse unless God gets a hold of somebody. He also called them children that are corruptors in Isaiah 1 and verse 4. It's no different today. His children are corruptors today. Just about every church you know corrupts the Word of God with the modern versions of the Bible. And this nation, it gets destroyed from the bottom up. It's many times the youth that bring in the new sinful trends. And then even the older people just go right along with it, get desensitized to it. You got all these filthy rappers, filthy musicians, singers, actors that are young. They bring in the filth. The young people get a hold of it. It ends up desensitizing even the older crowd. And you got children that are corruptors, people correcting the Word of God. In 2 Corinthians 2:17, Paul says, for we are not as many which corrupt the Word of God. But you got children that are corruptors all through the churches in this country. What you have today is guys getting up, claiming that they believe the Word of God, and yet they correct it and change it without it affecting their conscience one bit. They have forsaken the Lord. People today have forsaken the Lord. You got people walking around, and it's not like that they're just cussing God. It's that they don't even think about God, good or bad. They don't even think about Him one way or the other. They don't even want to retain God in their knowledge, as Paul talks about in Romans chapter 1. They have provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger. And that's a Deity of Christ verse. The Holy One of Israel. In Acts 3:14, it says they denied the Holy One. That's Jesus Christ. But they provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger. The Bible says in Ephesians 4:26, be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. So you're supposed to get angry. We should be angry over sin because God's angry over sin. My pastor, Donnie Dalton, he says, a preacher can't preach unless he's mad about something. And that's true a lot of times. The more mad you get about something, the better you can preach about it. In Mark 3:5, Jesus said when he had looked round about on them with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their hearts. The Lord Jesus Christ got angry, contrary to what these people today say with this another Jesus that they have. He said they are gone away backward, yet we're supposed to press toward the mark for the prize, Philippians 3:14, not go backwards like backsliders. When Moses was in front of the Red Sea, the Lord told him to tell the people to go forward. Exodus 14:15. Go forward. In the time of Jacob's trouble, you'll have people draw back unto perdition. That's Hebrews 10:39. That is the son of perdition, the Antichrist. They're going to draw back into perdition during that time. And interesting, John 6:6. John 6:66, matching the number of the beast. It says, from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. And he said, then Jesus said to the 12, will ye also go away? Why would you go away backward? Peter says in John 6:68, Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. Why would you go away backward? Why will people in the time of Jacob's trouble go back, draw back into perdition? Why do people today go back to their idols? Anytime you are going away backward from the Lord, you are focusing on the temporal and not the eternal. But the Lord says in Isaiah 1:5, why should ye be stricken any more? Ye will revolt more and more. The whole head is sick and the whole heart faint. This matches Genesis once again. Genesis 6:5 specifically, this is where their thoughts and imagination of their heart is only evil continually. Their whole head was sick. Their whole heart faint. Everything they thought about was evil and wicked. And he said, why should ye be stricken any more? Why should God whip them anymore? He's like, why should I chastise you anymore? They've gotten so rebellious that the spankings, the whoopings, when he gets the paddle out, it's no longer humbling them anymore. In Jeremiah 5:3, it says, O Lord, are not thine eyes upon the truth? Thou hast stricken them, but they have not grieved. Thou hast consumed them, but they have refused to receive correction. They have made their faces harder than a rock. They have refused to return. So the whole head is sick. That's where you get the saying, they are sick in the head, as they say. The heart is faint. So their thoughts and imaginations are completely in the gutter. Genesis 6:5. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. You know, today they talk a lot about imagination. Use your imagination. Follow your imagination. That's not very good advice, because every imagination of the thought of the heart of man is usually evil. The heart's deceitfully wicked above all things, desperately wicked. Who can know it? Paul says in 2 Corinthians 10:5, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. If your imaginations and thoughts aren't lining up with the book, then they're evil and you should not follow them. He says in Isaiah 1:6, from the sole of the foot, even unto the head, there's no soundness in it, but wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. They have not been closed, neither bound up, neither mollified with ointment. From the top of your head to the bottom of your foot, you're wicked. And Israel was wicked from top to bottom, absolutely repulsive to God. The putrefying sores have a bad smell to them even. For a man to be seen right in the eyes of God and not like this, not like somebody with wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. If you want to be seen right with God, you got to come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Then you can be made without blemish and without spot, 1 Peter 1:9, like he is. Since they haven't repented, they are seen as wounds and bruises and having putrefying sores that's not even been tended to or mollified. That means, you know, appeased, softened up. They're seen as having all these wounds and bruises and putrefying sores that they've not closed or bound up. That shows that they're unrepentant. They're not doing anything to fix the problem. They're just, looks like somebody standing there with pus and blood running out. He says in Isaiah 1:7, your country is desolate. Your cities are burned with fire. Your land, strangers devour it in your presence, and it is desolate as overthrown by strangers. So desolate, that is destitute and deprived of inhabitants. Their cities are burned like Sodom. Strangers are going to come through, devour it in their presence while they're still there. And it's overthrown by these strangers walking in and overtaking them. That's what the devil wants to do to you. He's a roaring lion that walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Jesus said to Peter, Simon, Simon, Satan hath desired to have you that he may sift you as wheat. He wants to devour. He wants to come in and overthrow everything in your life. You bring people in your homes who are strangers to the things of God through entertainment, and your family gets overthrown by them. Soon your life looks something like this here. He says in Isaiah 1:8, and the daughter of Zion is left as a cottage in a vineyard, as a lodge in a garden of cucumbers, as a besieged city. What used to be glorious, the daughter of Zion, is now without God. It's like a cottage and a lodge, like a little wooden shack in a vineyard or a garden, like a tool shed in the back of a ugly house. And it's in a besieged city, a city surrounded by the enemy, overtaken by the enemy. You see, they used to be beautiful for God. The daughter of Zion used to be where you would see the temple. Today, in your spiritual warfare, you got God in you. Even though you're surrounded by spiritual wickedness in high places, you're not just a lodge or a cottage. You're the temple of the Holy Ghost, 1 Corinthians 6:19 through 20. Don't turn your temple of the Holy Ghost, don't make it look to the lost world like it's some type of bar going around drinking all the time. Don't make it look like a drug house, putting drugs in it all the time. Don't make it look like a whorehouse, going around fornicating all the time. Your body's the temple of the Holy Ghost. Don't act like you're a wooden tool shed in the back of a shack somewhere, or a cottage in a vineyard, or a lodge in a garden of cucumbers as a besieged city. Isaiah 1:9, except the Lord of hosts had left unto us a very small remnant, we should have been made as Sodom, and we should have been likened to Gomorrah. Once again, matching Genesis, the first book of the Bible, because in it you see Sodom and Gomorrah in Genesis 19. You see how Isaiah 1 matches up with Genesis, the first book of the Bible. So Israel is a very small nation. Isaiah is speaking to the smallest kingdom, Judah, the southern kingdom. See, the northern kingdom was much bigger. And so there's a very small remnant that comes out of the smallest kingdom of this small nation. And this is a great illustration of what Jesus said, because in Matthew 7:14, he said, because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth into life, and few there be that find it. It said, we should have been as Sodom, and we should have been made like unto Gomorrah. That kind of puts you also in a tribulation context, because in that time it will be as it were in the days of Lot, Luke 17:28, and where was Lot? In Sodom and Gomorrah. And during that time, during the time of Jacob's trouble, Israel will spiritually be called Sodom and Egypt, Revelation 11:8. So like I said, doctrinally, this is Isaiah puts you in a tribulation, second coming, millennial reign context. Isaiah 3:9, he talks about the show of their countenance doth witness against them. They declare their sin as Sodom. They hide it not. Woe unto their soul, for they have rewarded evil unto themselves. Ezekiel 16:49, he said, behold, this was the iniquity of thy sister Sodom. What was their problem? Pride, fullness of bread, and abundance of idleness. That was their sin. And that's also what America's problem is. They got too much pride to go to work. They got too much pride to get right with God. They got fullness of bread. They got all the food they could want. They got abundance of idleness. They got all this time to sit around and get into all this trouble. What's a good saying? And the idle mind is the devil's workshop. The ingredients for God haters and sex perversion is pride, fullness of bread, abundance of idleness. That's what America's got. He says in Isaiah 1:10, hear the word of the Lord, ye rulers of Sodom. Give ear unto the law of our God, ye people of Gomorrah. Israel is so wicked, he is even now referring to them as Sodom and Gomorrah. That's who he's talking to Israel here, but he's saying, ye rulers of Sodom, ye people of Gomorrah. So it's very fitting for us to refer to America as Sodom, because it's a wicked, sex-perverted country that's full of hell and the devil. And if we don't get right with God in this country, he's going to burn it up. He said, give ear unto the law of our God. Today, man's ears are full of perverted rap songs, podcasts, everything ungodly. They're not giving ear unto the law of our God. He says in verse 11, to what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me? said the Lord, I am full of the burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fed beasts, and I delight not in the blood of bullocks or of lambs or of he-goats. He said, this is the key. What purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices? What's the motive behind these sacrifices and these offerings and these feasts and these meetings you're having? Is it really for God, or an attempt to outweigh their unrepentant evil with good? If the sacrifices and offerings come from an unrepentant heart, then the sacrifices and offerings aren't doing any good. They're an abomination. In Proverbs 15:8, the sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination to the Lord, but the prayer of the upright is his delight. The Lord doesn't even delight in good things if they are out of an evil, unrepentant heart. And that's the problem. What purpose are they doing these things? Just like at the judgment seat of Christ, he's going to try every man's work of what sort it is. Why did you do the good works? He's not so concerned with what you're doing it. He's concerned with why did you do it? In Isaiah 1:12, he says, when you come to appear before me, who hath required this at your hand to tread my courts? Well, the Lord has required it, but they're doing it for the sake of tradition, not because they love God, not because they want to do right, not out of a pure heart. So he says, bring no more vain oblations. These vain offerings that they got. He's like, bring no more vain oblations. He says, incense is an abomination unto me. Incense, that's a picture of prayer. Their prayer has become an abomination. The new moons and Sabbaths, the calling of assemblies, I cannot away with it. It is iniquity, even the solemn meeting. Their feasts and their getting together, their solemn meetings have become a sin themselves. Oblations are their offerings, but they are vain because their purpose behind bringing them is completely flawed. He says he can't away with it. He can't away with the Sabbaths, the new moons, and the feasts because he set them things up. But because of their heart attitude, he's calling it iniquity. They're doing it all for the wrong reasons, all with the wrong heart attitude. And he's beginning to hate it. And Amos 5:21-23, he says, I despise your feast days, and I will not smell in your solemn assemblies. Though you offer me burnt offerings and your meat offerings, I will not accept them. Neither will I regard the peace offerings of your fat beasts. Take thou away from me the noise of thy songs, for I will not hear the melody of thy vials. Compared to a church service or a big time revival today, you got these big time evangelists coming in who are on an ego trip, bunch of egotists. Their pride is written all over their face. I mean, they basically show their sin as Sodom. They hide it not. Their revivals are disgusting self-promotion, patting each other on the back. And that junk stinks in the nostrils of God. If the meetings aren't to praise God and to edify the saints, and it's to show God how, or to show the world how great you are, and look, it's an abomination to God, and it's vain, and God hates it, and he hates sitting in there. In Isaiah 1:14, it says, your new moons and your appointed feasts my soul hateth. They are a trouble unto me. I am weary to bear them. Just like today in many churches and preacher meetings, the Lord can't stand sitting in there. He's ready for it to be over. It's a total ego trip for many self-absorbed, so-called men of God, and God's long-suffering runs out in a mess like that. He's sick of it. It's a trouble unto him. He's weary to bear these church services he sees today. He says, and when you spread forth your hands, I will hide mine eyes from you. Yea, when you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. This matches Genesis once more. The Lord hides himself from Cain in Genesis 4:14 because he shed his brother's blood. Once again, matching the first book of the Bible, Genesis. Paul talks about lifting up holy hands in prayer. Israel and Judah couldn't do that because the hands were dripping with blood. One of the things the Lord hates is hands that shed innocent blood, Proverbs chapter 6. When it comes to me and you today, God isn't hiding himself from you because you're a child of God. If you're saved, he's not hiding himself from you. He wants you to talk to him. If you're a child of God in the body of Christ, you go directly into the throne room, and the moment you open your lips in prayer, you can be in fellowship, and he's hearing your voice. So here's the solution, though. is going to get to the solution here. Isaiah 1:16, he says, "Wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doings from before in mine eyes. Cease to do evil." He said, "Wash you, make you clean." This shows you that none of those things they were offering had been doing them any good. They hadn't been washed. He says, "Wash you, make you clean." They were supposed to do offerings and sacrifices, but since it wasn't out of a pure heart, it wasn't doing any good. The prescribed sacrifices would give them temporary forgiveness, but not if it wasn't out of a pure heart. It says in Proverbs 30 and verse 12, "There is a generation that are pure in their own eyes, and yet is not washed from their filthiness." That was them. In Psalm 119 and verse 9, it says, "Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to thy word." Ephesians 5:25 through 26, it says, "Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word." You got to get the word to get cleansed. As a born-again believer in the New Testament body of Christ, you're already washed in the blood permanently. Your soul is clean and spotless without blemish in the eyes of God. But when it comes to your practical walk in the flesh from day to day, the blood can also cleanse you and keep you in fellowship. 1 John 1:9, "If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." When you got saved, your soul was born again and made sinless, but you still have to cleanse yourself when it comes to the flesh and spirit. 2 Corinthians 7:1, "Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God." He said, "Put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes." The only way to get your evil ways from before his eyes is to completely stop doing it, because God sees it all. The eyes of the Lord run through the whole earth, beholding the evil and the good. We can't reach sinless perfection, but we should strive to live as close to God as we can until we shed this vile body. Then we won't have to worry about it no more. He said, "Cease to do evil." That means quit it. 2 Timothy 2:19 says, "Let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity." Now, 17 through 20, verses 17 through 20 is going to remind us of Genesis once again, like I said, specifically Genesis 4:7. In Genesis 4:7, he says to Cain, "If thou doest well, shalt thou not be accepted? And if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him." So, if thou doest well, you got a good consequence. If thou doest not well, you got a bad consequence. And that's what he's saying in Isaiah 1:17 through 20. He said, "Learn to do well, seek judgment, relieve the oppressed, judge the fatherless, plead for the widow. Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. But if ye refuse and rebel, ye shall be devoured with the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it." You see, he's telling him, do well, be willing and obedient, good things are going to happen. Refuse and rebel, bad things are going to happen. Same thing he told Cain. Isaiah 1:17, "Learn to do well, seek judgment, relieve the oppressed, judge the fatherless, plead for the widow." When you become a child of God, you have to learn to do well. Paul said, "Study to be quiet," 1 Thessalonians 4:11. Peter said, "To grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ." You got to learn some things. You got to learn to do well. And you learn to do well when you look at the Lord Jesus Christ, our pattern. He made himself an example of suffering for us. And Isaiah talks about helping those who can't help themselves as much as others can, the oppressed, the fatherless, the widows. Learn to do well, relieve the oppressed, judge the fatherless, plead for the widow. You see, the evil man, he sees somebody like that, he runs them over, takes advantage of them. That's not what a child of God should do. Job 31:16, 17 says, "If I have withheld the poor from their desire, or have caused the eyes of the widow to fail, or have eaten my morsel myself alone, and the fatherless hath not eaten thereof." You see that? He says in Isaiah 1:18, "Come now, and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." You see, God wants to reason with you. God is reasonable. Why would an almighty righteous God reason with us and the majority of men won't reason with him? Our sins are like stains and they stick out. Scarlet, that is like an orange red. Crimson, that's like a deep red, like blood. But Jesus Christ will wash you in his blood and make you spotless and as white as he is. He's the Lamb without blemish and without spot. In Isaiah 1:19 it says, if you be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 8:12, for if there be first a willing mind. He's telling Israel, if they're willing and obedient, they'll eat the good of the land. They got physical promises promised to them. God is wanting people who are willing and doing things out of a pure heart with the right purpose. What purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices, he said. You see, if you're willing and obedient, then there are guaranteed physical blessings. Today, if you're willing and obedient, you're guaranteed spiritual blessings. You're guaranteed rewards at the judgment seat of Christ. He said in Isaiah 1:20, but if ye refuse and rebel, ye shall be devoured with the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. If they can't get right with God, the strangers are going to come in and devour them in their presence. If you refuse and rebel today, you'll push yourself to an early grave. Romans 8:13, it says, for if you live after the flesh, you shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. Keep living for yourself, living for the flesh, you're pushing yourself to an early grave. The mouth of the Lord has spoken it, and he's never lied before. Romans 3:4, let God be true, but every man a liar. Isaiah 1:21, how has the faithful city become an harlot? It was full of judgment, righteousness lodged in it, but now murderers. You see, the faithful city became a harlot. Harlots aren't faithful to one man. Israel hadn't been faithful to one God. They committed spiritual adultery. An harlot doesn't have a real relationship, real love, or real safety. All a harlot has is money and material possessions. When you become unfaithful to the Lord, you start focusing on the temporal and not the eternal. Notice they were faithful when they were full of judgment. The Bible is for judgment. But the world says don't judge. The world says judge not, lest you be judged. Remember, they always say, but they take Matthew 7 out of context. It's talking about hypocritical judgment. Those verses weren't against hypocritical judgment. But 1 Corinthians 2:15 says, but he that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. And Paul says in 1 Corinthians 6:3, know you not that we shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life? If we're going to judge angels at the great white throne judgment, you can judge the smallest matters in this life. The sodomite wants to take away judgment. He wants to take away righteousness. But the result of that is a place full of murderers, a place like Sodom and Gomorrah. So they won't stop pushing the envelope with sodomy. It's going to turn into bestiality, pedophilia, and eventually murder, rape, and cannibalism. Once you take away judgment, you take away righteousness, and then you got every man doing what's right in their own eyes. Judges 17:6. He says, thy silver has become dross, thy wine mixed with water. They're getting watered down. Their princes are rebellious. They're companions of thieves. Everyone loveth gifts, followeth after rewards. They judge not the fatherless, neither doth the cause of the widow come unto them. You see, they're all about loving gifts. When you take gifts and rewards, it's going to end up eventually perverting your judgment. You're going to make your decisions based off of the money and the riches that are coming in. And you're going to sell yourself to work evil in the sight of the Lord. 1 Kings 21:20, just like Ahab did. And Isaiah 1:24, it says, therefore saith the Lord of hosts, the mighty one of Israel. He says, ah, I will ease me of mine adversaries and avenge me of mine enemies. God's relief comes from his vengeance. Jesus Christ is the ultimate avenger. Vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Romans 12:19. The Lord is the mighty one of Israel. He is the Almighty. Isaiah 1:25, he says, and I will turn my hand upon thee, and purely purge away thy dross, and take away all thy tin. He's going to fix them. He's going to turn his hand upon them. And for the lost, it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. For the saved, it's a comforting thing. God will purge or purify them the way metal is purified in a smelting pot. Look at Isaiah 1:25. And I will restore thy judges as at the first, and thy counselors as at the beginning. Afterward, thou shalt be called the city of righteousness, the faithful city. He's going to take the city and make it the city of righteousness once again. He's going to take Jerusalem and Israel, make it righteousness again. This will be in the millennial reign of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's when he's going to accomplish this. Zechariah 8:3. Thus saith the Lord, I am returning to Zion and will dwell in the midst of Jerusalem, and Jerusalem shall be called a city of truth, and the mountain of the Lord of hosts, the holy mountain. Isaiah 1:27, Zion shall be redeemed with judgment, and her converts with righteousness. Zion, that is Jerusalem, the city of the great king. The Lord will judge their enemies to redeem Israel from among them. Isaiah 1:28, and the destruction of the transgressors and of the sinners shall be together, and they that forsake the Lord will be consumed. Hebrews 12:29 says, our God is a consuming fire. When he comes back at the second coming, in 2 Thessalonians 1:8 through 9, it says, in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. They're going to be consumed by the fire. Isaiah 1:29 says, for they shall be ashamed of the oaks which ye have desired, and ye shall be confounded for the gardens that ye have chosen. These are like tree huggers and nature worshippers. They would get in these high places and under the shadows of the trees to worship their idols, because the shadow thereof is good, as it says in Hosea 4:13. And these oaks, these trees in the Bible, they're connected with bad things. For example, the young prophet sat under an oak and ended up eaten by the lion in 1 Kings 13. Jacob put the strange gods under the oak in Genesis 35. Back when Adam and Eve sinned, they hid themselves amongst the trees of the garden in Genesis 3:8. Once again, kind of matching Genesis there. Isaiah 1:30, for you shall be as an oak whose leaf fadeth, and as a garden that hath no water. Water, a picture of the Holy Spirit, a picture of the Word of God. But if you delight in the law of the Lord, your leaf won't wither, and whatsoever you doeth shall prosper. Psalms chapter 1. A garden with no water is a dead garden. You want to stay washed with the water by the Word so that you can bear the fruit of the Spirit and not get all dried up and fall apart. Isaiah 1:31. And the strong shall be as tow, and the maker of it as a spark. And they shall both burn together, and none shall quench them. Tow is flax fibers that are very flammable, and a spark set to it ignites a devouring fire. None shall quench them. Nothing can quench the lake of fire. When Jesus Christ comes back at the second coming in flaming fire, it's going to turn into a lake of fire on the earth. The idol and the maker of the idol are going to be burned up together. And these trees where men worship, the makers of the idols, the idols themselves, it's all going to be burned up. All the things that you worship in this life are going to be burned up. He's going to get rid of all the idols. The Lord alone shall be exalted in that day. So you see some heavy second coming verses. Like I said, doctrinally, what you got with Isaiah is the second coming, the millennium, the tribulation, restoration of Israel. But he said, ah, sinful nation of people laden with iniquity. That's the sinful nation of Israel. That's how America is today. That's how a lot of Christians are in their heart today. A sinful people. But he said, come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. If you're not saved, come to the Lord Jesus Christ and get saved. If you're saved and you're living wrong, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So come to him, get things right with him today before it's too late.